Hi there. Welcome to the new Greg Sterle Show. Hello, everybody out there in TV land. I'm Annie Sterle. This is my co-hostess, Michelle Sterle.
Hello again.
We're very happy to be here this evening. So here's what we're doing tonight. We're first introducing next week's hosts. How about that?
Yeah. What she said.
We got Ashman and Todd here with us.
Hi.
They're hosting the new Greg Sterle Show next week, don't you know?
Yeah, we're dumbasses and we showed up this week.
Is that really what happened?
That's actually what happened. Yeah.
No,
yeah.
We're just really punctual.
We walked in and yeah.
Todd just complains to me all the time. I mean, you know, he pulls rank age-wise, education-wise, income-wise, and then the last little plank is, hey, get off of color people's time. You know? So this was going the other way.
That was beautiful.
Well, we're all too happy to have anybody here as a guest on our show this week. So
that's for sure.
So these guys, see, we our shows are real free form, you might say. We sing songs and
unplanned
sometimes. Yeah. But the first question that you hit me with when I got here this evening was, "What's your topic?" And I was like, "What do you mean, what's your topic? I don't have a topic."
Topic.
We're not too topical, but. Next week, these two gentlemen are going to have what I'm sure will be an insightful and interesting discussion about race. Race in America?
Race actually viewed throughout the world.
Yeah, race in a global sense, because actually one of the things we'll talk about is the notion to which race is being destroyed or annihilated by things like globalization. And, you know, there's a very sort of happy, pat, well, there's only one human race kind of nonsense that we can talk
about.
Yeah,
right.
But there's a level at which that's totally true because of the pure inhumanity of, like, you know, the vectors of global capitalism.
True.
And racism, period.
Racism is going to be part of the show, and I think we're going to discuss it more from the capitalistic point of view.
Yeah.
About how it works really well to get certain things done, and it doesn't work well to get other things done, and how we confuse it as a moral issue, or it is a moral issue, but that's really not what changes things. Mm-hmm. What changes things is the capitalistic view of it. Yeah.
I believe that.
I gotta watch it. Damn.
I know. We don't want to preempt you know, all the things you have to say, but I gather that you two don't run out of things to say. Is that correct?
No.
No,
we never
do. Talking.
I met you 20 minutes ago, and it's been nonstop chatter. It's actually fascinating.
Oh, that's sweet.
I think that's going to be a good show.
Yeah, it's in a good way.
Todd is unbelievably well-read. He's a fantastic autodidact, and you know, he's got a really rich set of intelligences.
Did you just say autodidact?
And he's richer than you.
He's richer than
you. Older.
And he's taller, and so on and so forth.
I'm not taller.
I'm
so much
right now, I'm drunk, so that's my excuse.
That's the best excuse you've got.
That's
Are
why
you really?
I'm attacking. No.
No.
Oh.
He rhymed.
You'll know when he's drunk.
He arrived wearing a bathrobe, so goodness only knows, you know, where this one's been from. So you're an actor, are you, Todd?
I've done acting.
All right.
Yeah.
What? I know you once played Satan in a little film called Sweet Jesus.
Actually, that was typecasting.
How did you prepare for the role?
Just being myself. You know, most days don't go by where somebody doesn't compare me to Satan.
Yeah, he's being very modest. He actually reread Paradise Lost numerous times, which is great.
In Latin, actually.
Yeah, and it's important to keep in mind that Todd actually has a degree in restoration drama and this sort of thing. So
you have actually read Paradise Lost. Okay.
I have actually twice I've read Paradise Lost.
Wow.
Yeah, once when I was like 15.
Yeah.
And didn't really get it until I got the cool parts, you know.
Yeah.
And then it's great explaining Paradise Lost to people because I can, you know, I'm blue collar. I work as a carpenter and so I can really scale it
Jesus
down.
Jesus was a carpenter.
No, he wasn't. Jesus was a slacker. His dad was a carpenter.
Stepdad, thank you very much.
You're not my dad. You're not my dad. Stop it.
If memory serves, Paradise Lost is written in rhyming couplets, yeah?
Yes, it is.
What's your favorite rhyming couplet?
Oh, geez. You see, the problem is it won't rhyme. Because it was not written in. It was Milton. Milton wrote it, and he did not write. He didn't write it in English, did he?
Honestly, I don't know.
I don't think
so. I just got it from the country
Well, of course, the most famous is "Better to Serve in Hell Than Reign in Heaven." Of course, you know, and I have no idea how to say that in the original language that it was written in, but that's the one that I remember, and everybody remembers.
All right.
Is that the Inferno is the one that has Abandon All Hope.
Yeah.
But it's great because you know the whole story and you know how it
ends.
Well, you know, it doesn't end there because you got Paradise Regained.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah.
That's very true.
Yeah,
this is why we like Todd, because Todd knows those kinds of little tidbits, and Todd can talk about the fact that, you know, these things are metaphors for, like, these horrible wars, internecine civil wars between, like, the Roundheads and the Cavaliers, and this parliamentary struggle in the Jacobean era, and this kind of thing.
Oh, absolutely.
Where, you know, me, I'm younger than Todd, I'm about roughly 10, 15 years younger than Todd, so I deal with people every day who don't know what newsreels are. I'm just watching this educational film on the law. And there was actually a part in the segment where they're talking about the Youngstown versus Sawyer decision that Truman instigated, and they had to explain what newsreels were. And I'm like, what kind of a world do we live in where kids in high school don't know what newsreels are? You know,
they don't know what,
like, some in this room,
like LPs are, let alone newsreels.
This is not, you know, I wonder if they still call them turning in a paper at school when you submit it electronically.
Yeah.
You know, it's an anachronism, or soon will be anyway.
We're dating ourselves.
I Googled Paradise Lost original in Latin.
Yeah. Yeah, I thought so.
All right.
Oh.
Yeah. Yeah. But the whole story, that's a great story, too.
You gotta hand it to translators. Translators don't get enough credit for what
true.
They do.
That's true. I got a friend who's translating stuff from Spanish.
Don't you often wonder, like, wait a minute, did I, you know, what I read, can I trust that it was a good translation?
Yeah.
That's true.
Like 24. How do you really know?
What's that have to do with translation?
Oh, sorry. Well, that was spoken translation.
No, and this is a really, really sophisticated sort of idea, right? There's actually a whole book by Milan Kundera called Testaments Betrayed, which is about the act of translating. And in it, there's a really, really charming things he does. Like, he has four passages translated of this story by Kafka, four different translators doing it into English. And you look at it, and you're like, oh, my God, these four things are so unbelievably different. This is astonishing. And then it makes a certain amount of sense, right? Because you're translating Kafka out of the German. It's I don't know German, but as I understand it, it's a very simple kind of German that's very, very...
low German?
I don't know what kind of German in particular it is, but it's supposed to be very, very rich and very, very simple at the same time. So it's enigmatic and rich, but not particularly hard to translate. So what is your concern as a translator? Your concern as a translator is like, well, I want to be a famous translator. So in a sense, you want to, like, imprint this thing with some mark of yours, which in a sense is betraying the import of the work itself. And that was the point of this whole book.
The it's work like, couldn't be done without you.
Did you ever see the biblical translations where they, you ever see the pictures of, what was it, St. Peter with the dove on his head?
No.
And they realized that because the translations that the artist was working from, said that the Holy Spirit appeared as a dove instead of like a dove. So you've got all these pictures of St. Peter with doves on his head. It is fascinating. Anyhow, we've probably taken up.
Well, that's
way too
all right.
Much of your
time. I was just going to ask Ashvin, but aside from the fact that you sometimes wear bathrobes in the evening time,
yeah,
you know, whatever, is there anything else you'd like us to know about you biographically? Have you done any acting?
No. And it's probably one of those great deficiencies in my life. You know, I was born on October 18th, which technically is like the week of theater. I'm to understand. It's supposed to be a great week for people who get into drama, as it was for George C. Scott, who was born on my birthday, as well as Eugene O'Neill. I'm just getting this business degree, you know, and eventually going to law school, because I really don't think I can get employed right now.
I like the names you're dropping. I normally don't like name dropping, but Milan Kundera, Eugene O'Neill, you're doing all right.
Damn.
I hope so.
All right, well, that is a hint of what you have in store for next week. Thank you very much, gentlemen, for the preview.
Thanks for having us.
And we look forward to watching your show next week.
Thanks for having us.
Pleasure.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Good luck with
the show.
Pleasure. Yep. Thanks.
Bye-bye.
Welcome back. We're here for Sterlace.
Hello.
Sterlace Plus Plus.
Plus Plus Plus.
NJP. We now have
Looks at Books.
P.
That was Looks at Books, for sure.
What does that mean?
You know, just like it was all booky. When I came in, it was like...
I know.
Books, literature, you know, footnotes.
Yeah, we're like intellectuals or something.
You're smarty pants in it.
Well, this is all because of your suggestion, but we're here to commemorate the 100 with the centennial plus one of 1 Samuel Beckett's birthday.
Yeah, today.
He had many spots. Today. Well, that is today, the day of the taping, Friday the 13th. It's Friday the 13th.
Cruella.
But you're watching this on Wednesday or Friday.
Nothing bad happened.
Depending
on your
local. So anyway, here's a few words.
Oh, and then next week is 420. Great for all those, you know,
Earth
people.
Earth Day.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Earth Day. Will you be commemorating Earth Day at all?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
I make every day Earth Day.
We're going to watch
the Inconvenient Truth. Oh, that's great. I always call it The Unbelievable Truth by mistake, which is a good movie if anybody...
The Unbelievable Truth.
I prefer to call it The Inconvenient Loss.
Because of? You know,
because he lost. I mean, he really was
elected. That was
elected,
most inconvenient.
It was really inconvenient.
That's most inconvenient. I'm inconvenient really to
he
this
didn't
day.
Lose. He was stolen
he
from. But anyway.
He is the president. But it's inconvenient that he is not.
I couldn't agree with you more, NJP.
Okay. But in the end, maybe he's more of doing more good than he would have then doing what he's doing now.
Mm-hmm. He certainly has. Don't you think he's got so much unbelievable support right now, more than he ever could have?
I'm just glad he shaved the beard. That's all I care about.
So he done something right.
Oh, yeah.
Maybe he was cold and he grew a beard.
But that's one way to, you know, deal
could
with
be.
Global warming is.
Grow
yeah. Okay.
Beard. Anyway. Yeah.
So anyway, Samuel Beckett, ladies and gentlemen. On the stone, in the sun, gazing at the wheat or the sky or the eyes closed. Nothing to be seen but the wheat turning yellow. And the blue sky vowing every now and then you loved each other. Just a murmur. Tears without fail till they dried up altogether. Suddenly there in whatever thoughts you might be having, whatever scenes perhaps way back in childhood, or the womb, worst of all, or that old Chinaman long before Christ born with the long white hair.
Never the same after that, never quite the same. But that was nothing new. If it wasn't this, it was that common occurrence, something you could never be the same after crawling about year after year, sunk in your lifelong mess, muttering to yourself, who else? You'll never be the same after this. You will never be the same after this. I used to be a lectern in church many years ago.
And so you're channeling your lectern.
The skill.
I could tell. Or talking to yourself, who else, out loud, imaginary conversations. There was childhood for you, 10 or 11, on a stone, among the giant nettles, making it up, now one voice, now another, till you were hoarse, and they all sounded the same well, on into the night, some moods in the black, dark or moonlight, and they all out on the roads looking for you.
Close the book.
This is a reading from the book of Samuel Beckett.
That was That Time.
That was nice. Yes, that was an excerpt from That Time, 1976, by one Samuel Beckett.
Three voices.
One man.
One man.
Many influences.
That's heavy.
Mm-hmm.
I think there's a lot of people who like that theme, that three voices, one trinity thing, whatever. So yeah. Nancy, you're a real big Samuel Beckett fan.
Oh, yeah. Yes, she is.
I'm not going to front. I am a dabbler in Beckett, but, you know, you're a real scholar, I think.
I saw Waiting for Godot, but I'm practically a virgin in Beckett.
What do you like about Samuel Beckett, Nancy J. Parisi?
Poetry. It's all poetry in breath. It's really minimalistic, and it's just incredible, incredible writing. He's incredible. So he would create all these... You know, Kurt Vonnegut just died yesterday, April 12th. Mm-hmm. And I see, you know, I never really thought about it before, but there are a lot of similarities in their work, just in that there's kind of a really black, dark humor in their work. And their characters, I was just thinking, are kind of similar. They're kind of these ramshackle characters. There's a lot of chaos in the work. Trying to find sort of meaning and beauty in life. And Beckett's work, I just think it's incredible. So I got to study with Raymond Fetterman at UV.
I know you did.
And when I was just a little puppy.
Did he first turn you on to Beckett?
Well, no. Actually, there were a lot of plays being produced, Beckett plays being produced in Buffalo in the 80s. This man, Joseph Krizziak, I don't know whatever happened to him.
89 is when I saw Waiting for Good.
Well, so Joseph Krizziak, and I remember it was J-O-S-E-F, he was just doing all these productions. And so Beckett seemed to be everywhere. And that was an interesting time. There were a lot of minimalists. You know what's interesting is Philip Glass and Morton Feldman, the composers, are really influenced, they say, by Beckett. So, so Buffalo, you know, was like full throttle Beckett town for years.
Yeah.
So I was going to see all these plays and... You know, Rockabye premiered here, and they
that's
just
right,
remember we went to
yes.
that the Albright Knox.
That's right.
And Josephine Hogan did the show.
Yeah.
That was Billy
One
Whitelaw
Woman Show.
Premiered in Buffalo.
Oh, okay. And we were just hearing about a film of Not I, which is supposed to be really good, and that Billy Whitelaw or whatever, mm-hmm. she was the one woman in it. And that's actually why I did the lip thing at the beginning of the show for anyone who's been watching.
I thought it's a Julianne Moore was the lip actress.
She's got great lips, but she wasn't probably around.
Are you thinking perhaps
that.
Of Revlon commercials?
No, it said it on the
Andy
on the
McDowell.
Website.
Okay.
Anyways, if I wasn't straight and married.
I'm so excited about Kate Moss coming back.
No. I wouldn't call it excitement exactly, but Burberry's. Didn't they cancel her and then bring
her
back?
What about Rachel Weisz?
Who?
What about her?
Her replacement. I like Rachel Weisz.
Oh. Was she the replacement for the Burberry's?
Yes.
I like Rachel Weisz.
I'm ashamed to know that because I shop at Goodwill. So I don't know why I know anything about Burberry.
Oh, stop lying.
You're
crazy.
Michelle, you're always throwing those labels
like,
around.
Like, this is all like, this couture shit from Burberry's that she jets off to buy it. You know, come on, in the Hamptons.
I'm independently wealthy.
Yeah.
Indeed. No, honestly.
The only Michelle's thing I hate about Kate Moss is that she slept with Johnny Depp. What is it?
They
were together.
It's not fair.
It's not fair. It's not
I don't get it. Yeah.
I don't get the thing with Pete Doherty, but it's not for me to get, you know? Like she's
bad teeth.
Love. It's love.
What's to get? You got to have good dentition and good shoes.
He's a mess.
Yeah. So anyway.
But. Let you is
getting back to lipstick.
Getting back to lipstick. I do love lipstick.
I can't say I love lipstick. I know girls that can't live without lipstick. I had a friend,
I can't live without lip balm.
Maureen Ganey, to be exact, who used her lipstick so much and so hard that she always had this little crescent shape.
Oh yeah, Cheryl Smith. I mean,
Margaret
I don't think it's,
you have that?
I think it's no. I always figured it's something about the shape of someone's lips because
pressing
people's
real
mouths are
hard.
Like, you know, so unique. Anyway, we're in a book club together.
Yeah, we're in a book club. We have a great book club.
I would never have joined a book club except that it was Nancy's idea. And if anybody besides Fun Girl Nancy had suggested this book club,
well, we
I don't
were
think I would have wanted to.
We were gathered together by Michelle Giganti.
Uh-huh.
Not Michelle.
Not Michelle,
another Michelle.
Another
with
Michelle.
Two L's.
Yeah.
And she's a yoga
dancer. And
guru. I was going to say a guru.
All
and
about
theater
all around
instructor.
Cool girl.
She's, yeah.
She gathered a bunch of girls together. And so I was looking around the table and I said, hey, does anybody want to be in a book club? And then the rest is history a year later.
So one of your blogs, Nancy, was about technology, friend or foe. And I think there's something to be said about getting back to the
roots.
The roots, the book, as opposed to all this technology, computers and TV mm-hmm. all the time and zone into a book instead of into a screen. But I'm just saying.
Oh, yeah. You know what? Being a photographer, it does absolutely freak me out.
But keep watching, everybody.
Digital Please. Photography. Digital photography,
well,
you know?
Well,
it's like all my images, they could go kaflooey.
Yeah.
You Oof. Know, it's like negatives last forever. I have negatives from when I was 13. The digital stuff, it fades away.
I put my negatives in my safety deposit box.
That's a good idea.
Oh.
For my wedding and stuff.
I shot Michelle's wedding.
She did.
And she did a beautiful job.
She did a very good
Thank
job.
You.
Thank you.
That was a beautiful day. You're in my portfolio, and people always stop on that image
Come
when
on.
You guys were walking down the beach. Do.
We didn't know where we were going. We
oh,
just started
man.
Walking.
It was great.
Kind of like now. We don't know what we're doing. We're just walking
where
around.
Where are you walking to? Miss Champion, go out and come back.
Would she say that?
She said
the late
that
great Miss Joanne Champion Granger.
We all went to the same high school.
That was her maiden name, Champion?
Champion.
It was her first married name,
Rest
I think,
in
but,
peace.
Mrs.
Great.
Champion. She used to say, go out and come back, as if we would forget to come back. When we
so
had
at the end of
what, a bathroom pass or what?
Oh,
no,
okay.
We would have double classes of chemistry. And she would say, come back, as if she had to remind us, go out and come back.
Well, and you always came back, right? So maybe it was only because she reminded you.
I was tempted
you.
Not to.
Maybe you didn't have chemistry.
That's because you're such a rebel.
You.
You're like, don't and tell I'm, me to come back.
Oh, excuse me. If I want to leave, I will. No, I did several times. But
and
no.
Get expelled.
Well, back to a point Michelle started her AIDS a couple minutes ago.
Oh,
Nancy
right.
seems to stride very well the two worlds of the physical and the books, the hard copy and the old school. And the new technology stuff. She was certainly among my friends the first to have a blog.
Mm-hmm.
And the only one to maintain one long term. Today is not only the sixth correct anniversary of your blog, which was launched
Wait, I'm really
on Samuel Beckett's birthday, but It was launched on a Friday the 13th.
Yes!
Whoa, mm-hmm. Whoa, this is so weird. Mm-hmm. It was launched with these very words. Friday the 13th is a fine starting point for these rambling recollections. And an appropriate start is to roll out the rock and roll carpet of memory about Nirvana and Kurt Cobain, who strode off for eternity about this time of year. Nancy, photographed in black and white the band's appearance in Buffalo, New York at University at Buffalo in November of 1993. Surprisingly, there weren't throngs upon throngs of students or public rock appreciators there. Meat puppets opened, hiding under thick knit caps. That look is still around.
Mm-hmm.
And I watched from the sidelines where I encountered Mrs. Cobain, one Courtney Love, as well as shell-shocked UB students who had been dealing with her diva ways all day. A juicy later post will be my story about her, her handbag, and the tale of her leaving the handbag behind as she drove over the Peace Bridge into Ontario, Canada, for her whole gig in Toronto. But back to Kurt et al. The set was powerful. Kurt wore a trademark tattered cardigan over an Olympia Beer t-shirt. At show's end, he destroyed an in utero life-size figure, and thus began Epinwa. Everything's perfect in Nancy's world.
Oh, I can do the dance. Do that dance.
Everything's perfect in Nancy's world.
Nancy's world. Nancy's world. Can you tell she works out? Do you see how high she got?
Damn, she got some
air.
See
that air? She got some serious air.
Oh. What did she get from the Russian
it's
judge?
It's the shoes.
The Parisian judge gives her an
8.75. What?
Well, there's always room for improvement. Tell you the truth, I wasn't watching that closely, but... So anyway, everything's perfect in Nancy's world.
Yeah, it is. Where is that? Is this true?
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. So that blog has been around. You know, I was one of the first people that ever used Blogger, and they... long history with Blogger, and they sent their early bloggers actually Blogger hoodies.
Oh.
Which is pretty great. And back in the day, we used
to
actually...
Why didn't you wear it tonight?
I don't know. Actually, back in the day, we had to pay to have the advertising off of the blog.
Oh.
So I used to pay to not have advertising on my blog, and so, yeah, long history with them. So they got bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger.
So first of all, do you ever feel like your blog, are you ever uncomfortable with what you're revealing on your blog? And like, do you ever worry about how those megabytes travel out into the universe?
I actually know that I lost out on a job, a freelance job, because of the blog.
Wow.
Wow.
Because somebody was very uncomfortable. They had Googled me and they found the blog. And this guy was like really squirrely in the meeting. It was with a couple. And he said, oh, I saw your blog. As if like he spotted something really, you know, it's out there.
And
there's like a little shred of fiction in things, and there's a persona that writes it. It's not 100% me. And I always think that people will know that, but sometimes they don't. But yeah, this guy obviously was uncomfortable with something he had read, or I don't know what. Usually people like it. It kind of gives you this other dimension. And I'm a freaking freelance photographer. It's not like I'm an, you know, an air traffic controller or, you know what I mean?
Like my cousin Paul.
Yeah. So.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, but people, they're funny about when they've read something. They don't want you to know that they read it, as if it's like they stumbled upon your diary in a shoebox or something. But it's out there.
Yeah,
but it's
yeah.
funny like how people try to act like they've never looked at it or never read it. It's out there. So, yeah, it's an interesting experience.
On that note, I think it's time for us to put some music out into the world.
Yeah,
we
okay.
need to do a sing-off. Are you ready? Are you ready? We're ready. End clip. We are back.
We're back.
Again. We're back again.
Back
and it's time for a sing-off.
Back in black.
We're back in black, back in the saddle again, and that is very appropriate because we're going to do a sing-off.
Ba-da-dum.
For those of you who may not have viewed the last Michelle and Annie Sterley show... A sing-off is the concept whereby one of us sings a little snippet of a song, and whatever keywords are in that little snippet, it's the next person's job when we move on to sing a different song with one of the keywords from that previous song.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little musical association freedom ring kind of song.
I'm stressing out.
I know. And
a one.
We'll just
and
see.
And a you know
Here,
what to
here's
do.
What I'm starting with. On to you, Michelle. Even Even when the darkest clouds are in the sky, you mustn't sigh and you mustn't cry. Spread a little happiness as years go by. Please try.
Damn you.
Happiness, come on.
What about just happy, happy?
Shiny, happy people laughing. Meet me in the crowd.
People who need people. The luckiest people in the world.
Look at Lucky. She's a star, but she cries, cries, cries in her lonely heart, thinking, isn't she lucky, this Hollywood star?
Scratch, scratch, scratch. The dandruff is a-floating.
You must be my lucky star, 'cause you shine on me when I'm looking out. Of you and I start to glow and I need your light and baby. I'm so wrapped up in that song. I just stuck in the groove. I can't help it. I gotta go with get into the
groove.
Okay,
we'll accept that.
Oh, you've got to prove your love to me. Hey, get up on your feet. Let's stomp to the beat.
Prove your love.
No, that's mine. That's mine. God, damn it.
Take it away.
Prove your love. Got to prove your love. If you want to be with me tonight, strut your stuff. Those words are not enough. If you want to be with me tonight. Sorry about that.
Because tonight. We'll be at karaoke later in case you're...
Night moves, working on those aqua teenage blues, working on the night moves.
Why must I be a teenager in love? Why must I be a teenager in love?
Teenage wasteland.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Teenage wasteland. We're all wasted.
Bing, 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 bing,
why
bing.
Must I be a teenager in love? We're really teening out.
All right.
Love. That's a big old...
I know.
Smells like teen spirit.
Oh. With the lights out.
Not it's actually a lyric,
I know it's
is
not,
it?
Is it? Yeah. Yeah. All right. So I've got to go back to love. I want you, I need you, I do love you. Boom, boom,
boom, boom. I want boom, boom, you boom. To want me, I need you to need me. I love you, love me, I'm begging you to beg me.
Beg me. Yeah, that sounds right.
Scuba da dee dee da. Scuba da. Scuba da da da. Ba da ba ba.
I want
you. Light up my life. You give me hope to carry on. You light up my days.
Voices carry.
Hush, hush. The show's almost over. Voices carry. Carry on my wayward son.
There'll be peace when you are done. Lay your weary head to rest. Don't you cry no more.